Good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Friendly Hills. We are glad that you are here. As you are making your way to your seats, I have just a few announcements for you this morning. My first announcement is not this one. It is in your bulletins, but I wanted to highlight it because it's here this Saturday. But Jeremy Sink is going to be here from 9:30 to 11 in the Education Building in the AABF. All right, and so that'll happen this Saturday. So just, it's in your bulletin. The details are in there. I just wanted to draw your attention to that. My next announcement is First Glance. And so if you are new, if you are visiting here, if you are interested in becoming a member or what it looks like to be connected or what community groups looks like, getting a picture of that, then First Glance is the place to go. And so that's happening tonight. It's at 5:30. If you're new here and you have kids, we have Sunday evening programming that you can also drop your kids off. That's youth group. That's younger age, and that's even nursery level. And so if you have kids and you're new and you want to go to First Glance, we have Sunday night programming for you tonight as well. And so that's 5:30. There's a card that looks exactly like that out there at the front desk. If you have any questions about that, just come find me, and I'll point you in the right direction. My next announcement for you is Operation Christmas Child. The shoe boxes, they're going to be collected next Sunday. All right, so that's important. That's a week from now, next Sunday, November 19th. You can just place the boxes out in the front. There should be a table out there, and so you can just place them anytime throughout the week or by next Sunday. My next announcement, also next Sunday, is the Thanksgiving potluck. That's after the worship service. All right, and so this is a couple things with this. It's really important. One, in order for it to be a potluck, we need food to be there for the potluck. All right, we can all show up and hang out, but we would need food, and so please sign up for that. Okay, there is an awesome little QR code in the bulletin for that you can sign up. You can sign up for it through the e-letter, all the above. If you're having trouble with any of that, again, come find me. I will be more than happy to assist you in that. But so, yeah, just sign up for that. Also, in addition to that, because we are doing that right after church, that's going to be set up beforehand. So Sunday school hour is going to be in the sanctuary. All right. Sorry, I just saw someone walk in who I haven't seen in forever. That was wonderful. Sunday school hour is going to be in the sanctuary. All right. So I know normally we'll go over there to do that, but it'll be here Sunday. So all that's a lot is happening next Sunday, November 19th. All right. So just look at the calendar, look at the bulletin, and you'll be situated with that. December 3rd, my last announcement, December 3rd is Mistletoe Muffins. That's in the AABF. All women are invited. That'll be during the Sunday school hour. Bring an ornament, $5 limit, and a gift bag to share. You're going to meet in the AABF, and so just put that on your calendar as well. That's December 3rd. Any questions, again, find me. I'll point you in the right direction or answer it if I can. That's all I have for you this morning. I would like to now invite up James and the worship team, and I would like to invite y'all to stand as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning. So for those of you who may be new here, we begin our worship services with a call to worship where God is not only inviting us, but he's commanding us to come and worship him. And so it's an invitation for him to call us, to beckon us, to invite us to worship him. And so we come this morning. Sometimes we come prepared. Sometimes we come having an argument on the way to church. Sometimes we come distracted from everything from the past week. Sometimes just there's so many things running on our mind. And so the call to worship is really God's invitation to you to put all that aside and to worship him in spirit and in truth. And so hear now from your God from Psalm 66. Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies come cringing to you. All the earth worships you and sings praises to you. They sing praises to your name. Would you please pray along with me as we prepare our hearts to sing? Oh Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy in inviting us and commanding us to come and worship you. And so we come now, our hearts ready to sing your praises, to sing of your glorious name. And so would our worship, would our songs be pleasing to your ears, Father, and would it bring you much fame and glory? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. So now's the time where we can lift our voices and sing praises to our Lord. Please join me.
The times by grace will reach you.
seated, and I would like to invite up Mike Maynard.
Good morning, church. Good morning, visitors. One of the prayers that God hears from us in our worship each week is a prayer of confession. He invites us to come before Him as His children to ask for forgiveness, for we are never without sin. So let us pray together the prayer that you find in your bulletin and on the screens above. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, sin is my malady, my monster, my foe, my viper, born in my birth, alive in my life, strong in my character, dominating my faculties, following me as a shadow, intermingling with my every thought, my chain that holds me captive. Yet your compassions yearn over me, your heart hastens to my rescue. Your love endured my curse. Your mercy bore my justice. Let me walk in humility, bathed in your blood, tender of conscience, living in triumph as an heir of salvation through your blessed name. Amen. Now let us take a few moments to come before God with our individual prayers of confession in this time of silence. Hear this prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. O God, the King Eternal, whose light divides the day from the night and turns the shadow of death into the morning, drive far from us all wrong desires, incline our hearts to keep your law, and guide our feet into the way of peace, that having done your will with cheerfulness while it was day, we may, when night comes, rejoice to give you thanks. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And hear these words of assurance from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 2, verse 24. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Amen. Now we come to to confess the faith that we hold together. And we've reached the portion of the Heidelberg Shorter Catechism where we have reached the end of the Ten Commandments. And let me read to you the Tenth Commandment. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant or his ox or his donkey or anything that is your neighbor's. Now to covet, especially for you younger folks out there, means to desire wrongfully without due regard for the rights of others. I think that you will see now as we look at the response to the first question on the Tenth Commandment, it actually begins a summary of the Ten Commandments and deals with all the commandments collectively. So I will read the question and we will answer together. What does the Tenth Commandment require of us? That not even the slightest thought or desire contrary to any of God's commandments should ever arise in our heart. Rather, we should always hate all sin with all our heart and delight in all righteousness. But can those converted to God keep these commandments perfectly? No. In this life, even the holiest have only a small beginning of this obedience. Nevertheless, with earnest purpose, they do begin to live not only according to some, but to all the commandments of God. If in this life no one can keep the Ten Commandments perfectly, why does God have them preached so strictly? First, that throughout our life, we may more and more become aware of our sinful nature and therefore seek more eagerly the forgiveness of sins and righteousness in Christ, Second, that we may be zealous for good deeds and constantly pray to God for the grace of the Holy Spirit, that he may more and more renew us after God's image until after this life we reach the goal of perfection. In the weeks to come, we'll go to the last section in the shorter catechism on the subject of prayer, and we'll be looking in depth at the Lord's Prayer.
Please stand as we continue to worship, singing together. To invite back up Chris Jessup and Nathan Klein.
The other Chris Jessup. So this morning we have the wonderful privilege of bringing into our body here in covenant baptism The Williams family. So if y'all want to come up. So this actually is probably what this looked like in the early church, is that entire families would come. And here's why I say that. In remember in Genesis, Abraham, God asked him to put the sign of the covenant on his entire family. And so the entire family, including slaves, including servants and workers, all of them together, all like 350 of them had the sign of the covenant put on them at once. And then in Joshua 24, Joshua says to the people of Israel, he goes, now look, you guys may all want to break the covenant at some point, but as for me and my house, all of us together are going to serve the Lord. And we see that modeled for us in the book of Acts in Philippi, where the jailer, remember, comes to faith. And so he brings his entire family before the Lord, and they are marked with the sign of the covenant. Okay, and so in Ephesians 3, we see that the sign of the covenant in the Old Testament was circumcision. Good thing we're not going to do that, right, Alder? At least not here, anyway. But in the New Testament, it's baptism. And again, as we understand it, between the Old and New Covenant, that means families come together and place themselves under the sign of the covenant. So that's what we get to observe this morning and celebrate with the Williams family. So let me introduce them to you. This right here is Eleonora Libby Williams. This is Charles Faulkner Williams. Is that right? And this chubby guy. Love those cheeks. So when Suzanne was a little baby, she had cheeks about that big. Maybe bigger. But anybody. So this is Alder James Williams, and he's happy today. Look at that.
He's the only one you don't have to worry about.
All right. Everybody else is scared of me. It's okay. I have grandkids, and they like me. Livy says she wants to come to Poppy's house and live. So I'll take that. But we are so grateful for you guys to all come, and we are grateful to be able to bring you in to the covenant family here at Friendly Hills Church. We take that very seriously, as you know. We want to disciple everybody together from the cradle to the grave, that each of us may grow in maturity in our relationship with Jesus from the very youngest to the very oldest. All right? So in line with that, what I want to do is I want to read for Jamie and Shannon. These are your promises before God as part of the covenant family. Do you acknowledge that these children, as beautiful and as wonderful as they are, and sweet and all those kinds of things, are still in need of Jesus because they need the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit in their hearts? Do you acknowledge that? Do you claim now God's covenant promises on their behalf, that you will look to faith in Jesus Christ for their salvation just as you do your own? And do you now unreservedly dedicate these children to the Lord, promise and humble reliance upon his grace and mercy, that you will pray for them, that you will teach them the doctrines of Scripture, and that you will strive by every means of God's appointment to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? So say we do.
We do.
Amen. You do too. Awesome. So Ellie, if you want to come stand just right here in the middle, you can stand right by your daddy and mommy. Okay. I'm just going to put a little water on your head, okay? See? Mr. Travis is there. It's not too cold. So, Eleonora Libby Williams, on profession of faith of your parents, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Good job, sweetie. Ready, buddy? All right. right, so Charles Faulkner Williams, I now, on behalf of your parents' faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good job, buddy. Alder James Williams, on behalf of your parents' faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father. Woo! In the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Mr. Travis is going to pray and bless your family.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Williams family. Thank you for the faith that you have already made true in Jamie and Shannon. Thank you for the miracle of turning their hearts to you years ago, and we pray now that you would allow this family to see your faithfulness to them. We ask that you would set Ellie and Faulkner and Alder apart, that you would bring the faith of their parents to them as well, that these children would grow up to live their lives as vessels of honor, set apart for your glory. Father, we also ask that you would help us, the church, to come alongside this family, that we would invest in them, that we would love them well, that we would be able to laugh with them and to cry with them and to show them your love. In your name I pray. Amen.
Before we let them go, we like to do something here at Friendly Hills Church. We like to sing together with them, Jesus Loves Me. So let's sing together.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
All right. Good job. So I'd like to invite the real Chris Jessup to come up and lead us in sharing God's providence.
And the worship, yeah, the worship team along with them. All right, we're now going to continue worshiping through giving, and so with the ushers and with the deacons, please come forward, and would you please pray along with me in your hearts. Father, we have been invited in to worship you. And we have worshiped you through song. We have worshiped you through confessing our sins. Father, we have worshiped you through witnessing the sign of the covenant. And now we worship you through our tithes and through our offerings. And Father, we give not to earn your favor. We give because we have been giving everything in and through your Son. And Father, just as we hope that Faulkner and Ellie and Alder will grow to trust in you because of the grace that you have lavished upon their family, Lord, by that same grace, we give to you. And so with this act of worship, of tithing, of offering, would it be for your honor, for your namesake? Would you use it for your glory here in this town, across the nation and the world? It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Oh,
together as we continue to sing. Seated.
Well, as we continue our worship, I'd invite you to turn in your copy of God's Word to Hebrews chapter 12. So as many of you know, what we're doing is we're working through Hebrews chapter 12 on our way up to Thanksgiving to kind of lay a biblical foundation for why we give thanks in the first place. Last week we looked at how even in the difficulty of the toil and trouble of life, we can give thanks because right at the bottom of everything, when everything is shaking and falling apart, there is a kingdom that is unshakable that has been given to us in Jesus Christ. And this week we're going to look at how that affects our life. So if you would look with me, we're going to begin in verse 12, and I will read down through verse 29. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 12. Therefore, I'm sorry, people of God, please stand for the reading of God's word. Therefore, lift up your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Strive for peace with everyone and for holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled, that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that afterward, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no chance to repent, though he sought it with tears. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest and the sound of the trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, and the heavenly Jerusalem, and to the innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking. For if they did not escape who refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns from heaven. At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of things that are shaken, that is, things that have been made, in order that the things that cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. This is God's word. Please be seated. Please join me in prayer. And as I pray, I would like for those of you who are veterans or serve in the armed services to stand. As part of our prayer, I'd like to just ask God to bless you. So those of you who are veterans or have served in our military and our armed forces, please stand. Let's pray. O Lord, our Lord and Lord of all that is in heaven and earth, we come to you with full and thankful hearts today. We come to worship and adore you in all of your majesty and glory. We praise you that you know all things. Everything is clear and exposed before your eyes. Even the secret thoughts and intents of our hearts are completely known by you. And yet you offer us grace and mercy. You show yourself strong to those whose hearts cling to you and who are right in the heart with you. And Lord, we want to pray for those who continually have placed themselves in danger in the skies and upon the seas and throughout the world for our safety and our peace. We give thanks to those who serve and for those who have served in the military for our well-being. And we pray, God, that you will be a steadfast for them. That as Psalm 91 says, may 1,000 fall in front of them or behind them or to their side. But may you protect them and keep them in your care. We pray for this day and for our engagement with your word that we might be inspired and encouraged, that we might be changed through and through by your mercy and grace. And we continue in our prayers together, praying as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Children, if you want to be seated, veterans, thank you. We appreciate you. And children, if you want to be dismissed for children's worship, if you're visiting among us, we have our children go over to the Christian Ed building and they are given an age-appropriate lesson for them. As you can see, they love hanging out with Miss Cindy over there. She does a great job. So as we look at the passage today, again, we are going to start with verse 28, the end of the passage. It says, therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. So I want you to notice that phrase, let us be thankful. There's something volitional about being thankful. Part of it, we have to work on, we have to focus on, we have to strive for, and yet there's a significant element in thankfulness of surprise, of the unexpected, of the undeserved, actually. As a matter of fact, the word for grace and thankfulness in Greek is actually the same, charis. So let's go back to verse 25, and let's see what is so surprising. We're working backwards through our text. Verse 25, what's so surprising? The scripture tells us that the people of God miss something so vital that we should be careful not to miss the same thing. Let's look what it says in verse 25 and 26. See that you do not refuse him who is speaking, for if they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, much less will we escape if we reject him who warns from heaven. At that time, his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised yet once more, I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. So the writer here is telling us of a particular time in the history of God's people, when they were delivered from Egypt by all of God's power and glory and might. So they got to see this amazing display of God through the fire, through the cloud, through the plagues, through all of these extraordinary means. They saw the power of God. And then they saw the visual aspect of God's presence actually coming down on Mount Sinai. And it says that there was fire, and there was smoke, and there was thunder, and there was an earthquake, and they heard God speak, and the mountain shook, and the ground shook. And it says they were terrified. Truthfully, I think I'd be terrified myself if I saw all of that. It says they were so afraid that they told Moses, "You can go close, but there is no way we're going to even get close to that mountain." So our passage says that even Moses was afraid of the mountain. So we see that the people of God saw this incredible display of God's power and majesty, but they, and here's our word, a Greek word, says refused. Or another definition of that is to depreciate. To not get it to the point of gratitude or thanksgiving. They saw the awesomeness of God. They saw his raw power and glory. But in seeing it, they missed something incredibly vital. So much so that in a few days, they're making their own gods of gold. Yeah, it's interesting. Often when we lose our gratitude, when we lose our thankfulness for the gifts of God in life, what do? We go to idolatry. The people in the Exodus, they didn't want a God who terrified them, who overwhelmed them with their infinite power. They wanted a God that they could shape, that they could control. They wanted to be able to say to their God, "Oh, I'm so grateful that I can provide for my family. Oh, I'm so grateful that I'm in control of my destiny. Oh, I'm so grateful that I'm beautiful and that I'm wonderful and that I'm strong and that I'm smart," and all of these things. That's what they wanted to say. But truthfully, do we really want that? Is that the kind of life we want to live? A life where we are totally dependent upon ourselves? And for those of you who are trying to do that because you think that there's no other alternative, I want to ask you gently a question. How is that working out for you? Because my guess is that you become more and more discouraged that you can't get your life to work out the way that you want it to. Do you really want to be grateful for the things that you have made, or do you want to be grateful to the one who brought you into being? Do you want to be grateful for the things that you have fixed, or do you want to be grateful for the things that you couldn't have fixed, you couldn't have manipulated, you couldn't have controlled? Well, let's see. Let's see what the people of God missed at Mount Sinai. Here's what they missed. All of that power, all of that fire, all of that majesty, all of that smoke, all of that shaking of the ground, this power and fire and smoke and earth shaking, were all there to save them. It was for them. It wasn't against them. And that's what they missed. They thought it was against them. So how do we know that God is absolutely for us? We know because we're given things that we've never worked for ourselves. We know so because we see God fixes things that we can't fix. We know so because God is doing things for us that we never asked for or never thought about or never tried to get. Listen to what he lists here. Lots of things that we don't even see that are happening. He says, "But you've come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to innumerable angels in festal gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than Abel. So I was reading at the beginning of Paul David Tripp's Instruments in the Redeemer's Hands, and I read this paragraph. It says, what is your reason for getting up today? What moves you? What motivates you through the day? What is so worthwhile that you are willing to give it your time and talents and energy? What is so significant that you will build your whole life around it? Now, I have a confession to make. I love being a pastor. I really do. I love ministry. I love everything about it. But as I ask myself honestly, is that enough to get me up in the morning? And as I tried to answer that question as candidly as I could, I realized that it was surprising. That isn't enough. The thing that gets me up in the morning to be the pastor at Friendly Hills Church is God and His power and the way He works through the relationships of people. So I want to ask you, as you contemplate that part of this scripture, what surprising people and events has God brought into your life that you are thankful for? What amazing gifts of grace has He brought your way to encourage you, to strengthen you, to heal you? Now let's look at verse 26 and 27. That gratitude comes from hanging on the unshakable, the immovable. It says, at that time he shook the earth, but now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but the heavens. And this phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of things that are shaken. So verse 27 says, this is a time, again, referring to that time when God in the future will shake both the heavens and the earth in such a way that all the things that have been made will become unmade. All the things that are temporary will become completely destroyed, and the only things that are going to remain are the things that are eternal. He says that since we are receiving that unshakable eternal kingdom, that that's what will bring us gratitude. So in 1971 in Los Angeles, California, was the famous Sylmar earthquake. It hit the city in the early morning, 6:01 a.m. Roads buckled, overpasses fell, buildings came apart. In the San Fernando Valley community of Northridge, a housewife, Virginia Walters, said she was sitting at the breakfast table and the whole house began to shake terribly. The water cooler broke, about 4 gallons went on the kitchen floor. She said the lamps toppled, the dishes failed, the sidewalks cracked, and the furniture flipped over. 65 people were killed and another 150 were injured by this earthquake. And about $500 million in damage was done. But out of that disaster came a stress test. And it was developed for existing masonry structures to determine their ability to withstand the pressures of the earthquake. And then when the Northridge earthquake hit in 1994, measuring the same on the Richter scale, there was no structural damage. The test actually saved a bunch of lives. And that's what this passage is referring to. You see, here are two kingdoms in this passage. One is a kingdom of all the made things, and one is the kingdom of all the things that you can't see. There is this kingdom of all the things that you can't see that are eternal, and the writer has given us a test. He is saying, if you want to measure the stability of your life, do so by the things that you can't see. So, for example, you might be disappointed in the results of the election on Tuesday, or you might be disappointed in the way things have worked out. But he's saying, look, if you start thinking about that, you're going to be really discouraged. But if you think about the kingdom of God, that is an eternal kingdom, and you think about Jesus Christ, who is the eternal king, your disappointment will be there, but it's going to be short-lived. In other words, hook your experience of gratitude into the things that you can't see. Because when you do that, you will find that that your gratitude lasts. Let me apply it to Thanksgiving. Here's what I mean. When you sit down at the Thanksgiving table and all you see is mashed potatoes and turkey, you're going to walk away happy, satisfied, and probably sleepy, but you won't be filled with gratitude. And here's why. Because you're not thinking about all of the miles driven of the family around you. You're not thinking about the hours and hours of labor that went into that meal of love. You're not thinking about all of the family who are there, and you're not thinking about all of the family who couldn't make it. But when you begin to see those things that you can't see, suddenly your heart is full of gratitude for what's in front of you. And so it's saying here that in the hidden hand of our Creator, whom we can't see, that most often when we see the things that He's doing around us, that lifts our hearts in a way that causes us to say, thank you, God. This is amazing. If we see just the physical world, we see a lot of suffering, we see a lot of injustice, we see a lot of sinfulness. But when we look at the biblical record and realize that God has been working for thousands of years to prepare a day of redemption, Martin Lloyd-Jones says that sin is a big problem, even for God. It took Him thousands of years to redeem it. When we start thinking about that and we begin to experience some gratitude, when we realize that we could easily have been lost by our own failings, and yet we see God working behind the scenes to work out our salvation and redemption, when we see that God has salvaged our lives and much of the goodness of this world with it for no apparent reason other than His love and grace, then something different happens. Our hearts begin to fill with gratitude. Now, I've preached parts of this sermon before, but this is the part I haven't preached, which is there's something about gratitude that changes every aspect of our life. And that's what we find in verses 12 through 16. I'm sorry, through verse 17. So let's look back. There are four things here. Verse 12. Therefore, lift up your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees and make straight paths before your feet so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather healed. One of the things that gratitude brings to us is a deep healing from discouragement. Suzanne and I and a few other people recently were at the CCEF conference, which stands for Christian Counseling and Educational Foundation. And this year, the conference was on trauma. If you know anything about trauma, you know that what happens is when you experience trauma is that it literally takes over your entire physical body and your spiritual body and your emotional body. Because what happens physically is that all of your neuroreceptors get overloaded with the trauma, and you can't feel, you literally cannot experience anything else. And the psychiatrist who is describing this for us called it a liturgy of trauma. That literally everything becomes hopeless. Everything becomes totally discouraging. And you cannot break out of that because your system is overloaded with evil, with ugliness, with difficulty. But He also said that the antidote to trauma is beauty. And then He began to talk about a liturgy of beauty. That when we begin to see God's eternality and His grace and mercy, or even just see the beauty of His world around us. One lady told this story of how she was in the hospital. She was incredibly discouraged, but outside was this beautiful tree. And every time she looked at that tree, it began to fill her with the beauty of it, and it helped her get through the trauma of the surgery and the healing that she needed. And so what it's asking us to do is to immerse ourselves, to focus ourselves, to build our lives on the beauty of Christ and His great kingdom, which is unshakable. That when that happens, it becomes a healing balm for our souls and literally for our bodies. Because that same thing that causes trauma to overload our circuits, beauty does the other thing in reverse. And when beauty overloads our circus, trauma cannot get through. Number two, verse 14. He says, strive for peace with everyone and for holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. So another product of gratitude is peace and purpose. Now, scholars don't all agree on whether everyone actually means everyone or just Christians. I'm not sure it really matters. Jesus tells us to live at peace with everyone, even our enemies. So whether the writer means it here or not is really immaterial. God means it here. So gratitude in God's kingdom brings us a confidence that we can actually be at peace with people, that we can actually be at peace with people who don't like us. Because there's one person who we do know likes us. He loves us. It's God himself. And notice that he also gives us a purpose. He says, without holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. So what does he mean here? Holiness we often interpret as being perfect. It doesn't mean perfect here. It doesn't mean you obey the Ten Commandments perfectly, because if that were the case, we'd all be sunk, obviously. But it just means being set apart for this unshakable kingdom. It means we simply say to God, let me serve in your kingdom with who I am and what I have. I will live to serve. I will live to bring peace. I will live to love. I will live to speak of the glory of Jesus and the unspeakable, unshakable kingdom. And when we find peace and purpose in that gratitude for this unshakable kingdom, it changes us. It makes us peacemakers. Now, notice that it also does something really deep within us. Verse 15. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled. In other words, gratitude for this unshakable kingdom helps us gain understanding of grace, and helps us gain our understanding of how grace releases us from bitterness. You see, bitterness is actually the spiritual opposite of grace. Think of the book of Ruth. Naomi comes back to the land, and people say, oh, look, it's Naomi. And she says, don't call me Naomi anymore. That means pleasant, but call me Mara, which means bitter, because I went out full, but I came back empty. And she doesn't see the grace of God in that. Lamentations 3:18, the writer says, Jeremiah says, all I had hoped for from the Lord is lost. That is bitterness. Grace is when we see clearly that God has given us everything in Christ, that he has given us everything in this unshakable kingdom with all of its goodness, with all of its beauty, with all of its wonder, and it's granted to us purely out of God's goodwill. Not because we have some way of entering it or doing it, but simply because God has gifted it to us through his grace. And when we realize that, something powerful happens in our souls, and it releases us from bitterness. Notice verse 16. Now what I want you to notice is the unusual twist he takes on. Says, see that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. So he calls us to watch and be careful not to be sexually immoral. It's that word we've talked about before, pornos or pornea. It's the word we get our word pornography from. But notice that he takes it in a little different direction here. When we think of pornography, we don't think what happens in this passage. He describes Esau's lust for food as pornography. Why does he describe it that way? Because they have things in common. The lust of the eyes makes a man or woman willing to sell everything that God has given them, respect, family, home, honor, just for a few moments worth of pleasure. And if you're honest with yourself, you've been tempted at times to trade everything away for a few moments of pleasure. You're willing to give it all up just to feel good for a moment. But notice what Esau was willing to do. He actually did it. He sold one of the most valuable things in his life just so he could gobble down a bowl of of lentil soup. And my guess is he didn't even taste it. And that's what pornea is. It's trading away the glory and beauty of what God has created for a moment's worth of our own satisfaction and pleasure. But when we take a moment to breathe, when we take a moment to think, when we take a moment to reflect upon all that God has done, thousands of years, hundreds of prophetic messages, millions of agonies that fell upon Jesus just to save us in this moment of time, our perspective changes. We see our lives, and we see our lives through the eyes of gratitude and grace. So, how do we know that this is all true? How do we know that this will produce gratitude in us? Because there's another mountain. It was a mountain called Golgotha. And the same things happened on that mountain. There was darkness. There was an earthquake. There was thunder. And on that mountain, all of the things that we failed in fell upon Jesus for us. And because of that mountain, we know that God is absolutely for us. Because he has given us that in Jesus Christ. And that's really the heart of gratitude. Romans says it this way, look, guys, if God is willing to give you his son and crucify his son in your place and give you all of these things in Jesus Christ, how much more is he not going to take care of you and give you all things that you need? And that is really what he does. When we see the truth of all of the things that God has given us, most of them are unseen, we suddenly are filled with gratitude. So I pray this Thanksgiving season that you do take time to reflect on the things that you can't see, on the mountain where Christ experienced the darkness and the shaking for you, and let that fill your heart to the full with gratitude. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for these words. Thank you for the way in which you have worked them out in our own lives. Thank you for these incredible gifts that you've provided for us. The gift of freedom from God's anger. The gift of being terrified of God. And no longer do we have to be afraid, but we can know that God loves us with an eternal and everlasting love. Thank you, Jesus, for granting us all these great and precious promises. For we pray this, Jesus, in your name. Amen. I'd like to invite the worship team to join me on stage again as we close out our service. We are going to sing a song that kind of wraps this up. That one day our feast will be with Jesus in that final kingdom, in that unshakable kingdom. So let's join together in singing the promise, we will feast in the house of Zion. Please stand with me as we sing. With the hearts restored. after I give the benediction, if you could leave the microphone on just for a second. People of God, receive this blessing from your Heavenly Father. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom of priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Please welcome and greet the Williams family. There's a bunch of them. So great to have you all here this morning. And also today apparently is Chris Jessup's birthday, so we should embarrass him by singing happy birthday to him. Huh? Did he leave? Oh, okay.
Happy,
all right.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Chris. Happy birthday to you.
Woo! All right. You guys have a great Sunday.